Welcome to Whirlow for our Advent communion service in the second week of Advent. And welcome to anyone who may be following us online. Traditionally, this week is considered, can be considered as the week where we consider the word faith, faithful waiting, as we read from the prophets who waited faithfully for God's promise to be fulfilled. And that is our opportunity this morning, just to consider what faithful waiting means for you. Let the world hold its breath, for good is coming in all its vulnerable newness. Deep within our life, a wonder is conceived, hidden in humanity's moments of faithfulness. Look for it is near. Believe in it, for it is of God. Be ready to nurture its life among us, for it is a precious gift for all history. Spend a moment just considering those words. What are they saying to you? What good in all its vulnerable newness is coming to you? Is there something deep within you that you still feel is hidden? That in your moment of faithfulness you might just grasp a glimpse of? Look for it is near. Believe in it, for it is of God. And be ready to nurture its life in you and among us. For it is a precious gift. All history. So we pray, most mighty God, that you will reveal to us, give us the gift of waiting on you, to catch that glimpse of what you have for us deep within us. May this Advent be a time where we really are faithful in our waiting on you. Amen. So the Old Testament reading for today is from Isaiah 40, those wonderful verses. The previous 39 chapters have really been a consideration of all that was wrong in the life of the nation of Israel and the nations around it. And then we come to these glorious, wonderful, compassionate verses in Isaiah 40. Comfort. Oh, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and their rough places a plain. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. I don't know what words may have sprung out to you. For me, when I read this for the first time in preparing for this service, I was just so aware of the words of comfort. There is that word, comfort. Tenderly speak. He feeds. He gathers. Carries close to his heart. He gently leads. And if we think of this in the context of when it was written, and for the people that it, for whom it was written, these were words that needed to be heard by these people who were in exile. The previous 39 chapters have painted a picture of an all-encompassing brokenness, a rupture between God and God's people and creation. Sounds familiar? And I wonder, as we apply this to our time today, the context of the nations today, context of our communities, the context of our own individual lives. What are the words that speak to you? Comfort. There is a thought that these opening verses, that first verse, is a conversation, a heavenly conversation. We look at the icon of the Trinity, it's as if the different persons of the Trinity are saying to each other, comfort. Oh, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly. That is what Advent is about. It's the anticipation. It's the remembering of that time when God looks down on this earth, sees all the brokenness, and says, it's time to come and reveal and to speak tenderly. It's time to tend the flock like a shepherd. It's time to gather the lambs in our arms, this is God speaking, and carry them close to our heart, and to gently lead those that have young. We need to hear that. I need to hear that this morning. But as we hear that, also be conscious that in these verses, we are called to bring that good news to those that need to hear it, to show it in some way. Here we have a picture of going up on a high mountain and just shouting it out. Lift it up, lift your voice with a shout. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, say to the city of Sheffield, here is your God, the sovereign Lord, who comes like a shepherd. So have a time of quiet. And have 10 minutes. Just look at those verses. Sit with what you're drawn to. Those are the opening verses, words in our service sheet say, look for it. For that good, that wonder that is being conceived in each one of us. And be ready to nurture it in this time. Come to our prayers of concern. And we'll use this passage as a framework as we consider outside of ourselves those who need our prayers. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. In the silence, bring to God those that you know personally who need to hear that word of comfort, who need to hear the tender voice of God. And perhaps you are the vehicle for that tender voice. So ask for the grace to be God's voice. Lord, in your mercy, the uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. There is so much talk at political level of levelling up, of level playing grounds. But what does that mean? Let's pray for our leaders. They play a part in making that a reality in our country. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up, do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. Let us pray for those in our faith communities in leadership. They're not the only ones, of course, that spread the good news. We are as individuals. But for those in leadership who have the ear of the politicians, of our councillors, let's pray for them that they will not be afraid to say, here is your God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And lastly, this may be for you or for someone you know who's finding it very difficult. Actually, hear the voice of the shepherd. To actually feel the arms of the shepherd around them. To actually find it difficult to feel the heartbeat of the shepherd. Let's pray for an opening of eyes, of feelings, of ears, to be in touch with that shepherd this Advent. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer,
and let our cry come unto you. Amen. And so we thank you, God, that we may expect miracles beyond our dreaming. We thank you for the powerful witness which comes to us from the prophets, and for the fact that their lives challenge our own. And so we come to the time where we remember the story of that life, of God becoming human. We invite you to join in with the bold prayer. As we prepare to celebrate his birth, we remember the life that this baby will live. We remember how to show all what the banquet of hope could be. He ate openly with the despised and the outcast of his world. And we remember one special meal, foretaste of the banquet that is to come, that he ate with his closest friends. And at the end of the meal, he took bread, blessed and broke it, then passed it to them, saying,
take and eat. This bread is the body of life, broken by the world. Eat it in remembrance and in hope.
After that he took the cup, blessed it and passed it to them, saying,
this cup is the sign of the new covenant. Whenever you drink it, remember me, for I shall not eat or drink again until the time of the heavenly banquet.
So remembering the birth of the child in Bethlehem, we remember also his life, his death, and his resurrection.
We remember how he he poured his love out to all he met, and took them forward to his return, and the coming reign of peace, love, and justice.
And in our remembering, we declare the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will appear again.
God, you poured your spirit on the prophets. Pour out your spirit upon us gathered here. And on this bread and wine. As we eat and drink, may we know your presence. As we eat and drink, may we be open to the possibilities of your hope and power. And may we be strengthened in our time of waiting for peace and justice, so that we will have the courage to make the Christmas promise a reality. The bread we break is the bread of life. The cup we share is the cup of promise. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So come and eat. The banquet awaits. Jesus said, take and eat. This bread is the body of life broken by the world. Eat it in remembrance and in hope. Jesus said, this cup is the sign of the new covenant. Whenever you drink it, remember me. The prayer following communion, the blessing. What's coming through my mind is an image that I saw on the news last week after the snow, and you might have seen it. There's a shepherd, a farmer up in the Yorkshire Dales, literally entering a hole of ice and snow and dragging the sheep out. And it, just the lengths that those shepherds go to look after their sheep and to protect them. And I just think, okay, I'm thinking about the shepherds in the time of Israel, Isaiah, and that land, they would not have the snowdrifts that they have in Yorkshire Dales. That the lands that the shepherd has to tend his flock, to gather the lambs, and to carry them close to his heart. And if you wish to read some, reflect more on the shepherd, shepherding, then the blog this week on the website, written by our friend Adrian Scott, looks at this from a different perspective. But shepherding, what does that mean? And the comforting of the sheep. So break into our lives, O God. Bring down justice like rain upon the earth. Raise up from within the depths of our lives love that will never let our neighbours go. Cover us with healing grace and conceive in the centre of despair surprising freshness and energies for creative change. Surround us with ideas which spring up like green shoots in concrete, defying dryness and challenging deathliness. We say that and we pray that with that promise of miracles that we can't even begin to imagine. So go in peace, and in faith, and in hope, and in love. As we move into this, continue to move into this second week of Advent, in anticipation of all that the Good Shepherd has for each one of us. Those we love, those we don't love, and those who are not even aware of the Shepherd's love as yet. Amen.